Okay, I see the attendees are joining. Nigel, would you like to start sharing your screen? And meantime, I wait another minute for the attendees to join, then I will start with a welcome. All right, so mindful of the time, I will start at this point. So hello everyone, and welcome to this joint keynote session of MSAT and BPMDS. I hope that everybody had their morning or evening coffee, depending on your time zone, and that you are ready for another intense day of interesting talks on Zoom. So for today's industry keynote, we have the pleasure to host Nigel Adams. Nigel is director at Hetton Advisory. It is an Australian consultancy company, and he has a vast experience in management consulting across several industries, from manufacturing to finance. However, his experience within the finance sector did not stop in consulting. In fact, Nigel held executive roles at two of the four largest banks here in Australia for over 14 years, running payment operations and operational excellence programs. Today, Nigel will delight us with a talk on process improvement, reporting some of the lessons he learned during his career and highlighting how sometimes theory clashes with reality. On behalf of all the attendees, I welcome you, Nigel. And without any further ado, I leave the virtual floor to you.
Okay. Thank you, Adriano, and good afternoon or good morning, everyone, and thank you for taking the time to attend. Just a sort of quick health warning, I have with me a very large German Shepherd, so if you suddenly hear some ferocious barking, don't worry, the koalas will be saved. This case study that we're going to talk through takes place between 2011 and 2018. It's an attempt to highlight some of the challenges a leader faces when trying to introduce BPM frameworks, tools, and techniques to improve processes within a payments operation in a large mature bank. There are four banks, as Adriano mentioned, in Australia, and the start point for the case study is when I moved from National Australia Bank, or NAB as it's more widely known, to ANZ. At NAB, I had three jobs. My first job was head of manufacturing. It was a strange title for a bank, but it was responsible for improving performance across the operations function by drawing on some of the lessons learned in the manufacturing sector. In this role, I had to figure out how to run an operations improvement program, which frameworks, tools, and techniques worked, which were acceptable to the line leaders, decide the right makeup for the process improvement team, and also figure out the right operating model. 1 year and four restructures later, I was asked to lead the banking services team, which was a line role in charge of transaction banking operations, such as payments, supply chain, finance ops, onboarding corporate and institutional customers and client service. In this role, I learned how to fly the plane and build the plane at the same time. And there's more of that later. And I was responsible for both running the day-to-day, but also putting into practice what I'd preached in my support role. And then my last role at NAB was Dean of Operations Management in the Bank's Academy, where I learned how to build broad-based operational and process capability and train people from a wide range of backgrounds and functions within the bank. My new role at ANZ was Global Head of Payments and Cash Operations. So it's similar to the line role I'd held at NAB, but a little bit bigger and with a much broader geographic footprint. And what I thought going into the role was that my three NAB jobs had really set me up perfectly. And so in the week before I was due to start at ANZ, I took myself off camping to the Great Ocean Road, which is pretty close to where we live in Melbourne. And I used the time and the clear headspace to really figure out my 100-day plan. How would I bring all those lessons I'd learned into practice in my new job? What could possibly go wrong? Well, the first question is, where do you start? In essence, at NAB, we'd leveraged something called the Business Excellence Framework. It's similar to a European EFQM model. We had a good shake of Lean Six Sigma in there, a splash of Deming, a hint of theory of constraints, and a sprinkle of in-house maturity model. We deliberately stripped away all the language and jargon to make it fit the organizational culture. And this happened as a result of one of my team inviting a group of senior stakeholders to a high-impact Kaizen event and being told, we're a bank, not a car manufacturer, and no one turned up. So in essence, the mashup we had was broadly aligned to the BPM lifecycle. And as we know from the BPM lifecycle, the first thing you do is identify your processes. Too easy. Well, in reality, let's just say identifying processes wasn't my number one priority. Within the first 2 days, I was running daily war room calls with a group, with a couple of country CEOs, angry about the performance outcomes their customers were getting from poorly executed offshore processes. We had issues with regulators over privacy breaches and exceeding our allowable outage time for some of our critical payment systems. I had a procession of bankers queued up to get into my diary to tell me all the things that were wrong with my team. I had serious staff engagement issues. After years of offshoring and cost cutting, they were mistrustful and very wary of any new senior executive brought in to beef up operational excellence, i.e. cut more jobs. The previous incumbent in my role had overspent the budget and I needed to reduce headcount immediately to get back on track. And I had some very tricky stakeholders. When I took my initial plan to my primary business stakeholder, it was a strategy on a page, a typical McKinsey three-way phased rollout of the BPM type model. He tore it up and threw it out. I want results now, not in 5 years' time. And so the key message was, doesn't matter the reality of where you want to start. The real point is to follow the noise and damp it down. You may go in with a plan, but the environment you're operating in will quickly tell you whether you need to pivot. So it was really confronting. And the guy that sort of dressed me down and tore up my plan was a very sort of, very senior, but also is a very large imposing figure. And I just remember sort of being in the room with him as he just basically destroyed everything that I put together. But what we know is that it's hard to improve an unstable process. The first thing you have to do is to get it under control. And just because you don't have lots of the inputs you'd normally expect to be in place doesn't mean to say you don't create a plan. Otherwise, you end up like Alice in Wonderland. You know, if you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there. So the revised plan was basically split into three phases. Get the business under control. Oops, sorry, just let me turn my light off. Get the business under control, then simplify it, and finally automate. Sorry about that, I just had a sort of a wonky light. With the control, for me, it seems, I don't know if there's something about me and the jobs I go for, but every single business I've been in, I've had to get the business under control. And it's about stabilizing the business. And if you join a team and you don't have to do this, you're very, very lucky. There are four things you tend to have to do. The first one for me is about setting the context. You know, it's usually about creating a 100-day plan. Well, I had a plan, but I'd thrown it in the bin and I was now ready to start from scratch. So I had to understand the current lay of the land and do a current state assessment before coming up with a game plan to move the business forward. The next area of focus was on the people. If you don't get the people basics right, there will be no improvement. Leadership is very simple. All you have to do is show people how to get from A to B and convince them to follow you. But they won't follow you if you haven't got the hygiene factors right. So this includes things like making sure we were managing health and safety appropriately. Contracts were correct. People had contracts. Their job titles were correct. They had job descriptions and development plans. They were graded correctly, paid correctly. Targets were fair and they had performance reviews. There was diversity in the team and an open culture where people aren't afraid to speak up. All of these ingredients are essential to forming a foundation upon which you can improve. And if you don't have a high trust environment, you're going nowhere. And it takes time. These are very much small and in the detail type issues that you have to face into. The next area was a focus on metrics. We all know that what gets measured gets done. And in my experience, few banks are good at measuring process performance. Financial, people and risk metrics are usually okay, but there's a real gap in the process metrics that drive in particular the customer financial and risk outcomes. Without this data, having a team of process engineers is like having a stable full of thoroughbred horses taking donkey rides on the beach. And finally, we needed to get to grips with capacity. We were being set some really tough headcount reduction targets. We didn't have a good grip on capacity management. We needed to understand the demand profiles over a range of time horizons. And in most services businesses, it's a chase the demand plan. So we needed to understand how to flex our capacity to deal with the peaks, troughs, and the surge demand that used to come through. More critically, we had to deal with the level of overtime the team were working, you know, both from a health and safety and financial perspective. It was very significant. So this involved things like balancing the FTE mix between permanents, part-time contractors, looking at the use of flexi time, annual leave, planning, overtime, lending and borrowing resources, upskilling, cross-training, etc. A whole raft of measures just to try and free up capacity, find time. And the key message here is that while my original plan was to focus on building process maturity and improving core processes, in reality, we didn't touch processes in the first 6 to 12 months, apart from when we had sort of critical failures. But we did significantly improve the business. And you know, before I go on to what we did in the simplifies phase and some of the challenges we faced there, I thought I'd share the current state assessment that we did. In essence, what I was asking was, what have I got? What am I accountable for? And it should be pretty easy. Get the facts on the table, plot out a new course, and away we go. Well, in terms of facts, there were very few and far between. I knew how many processing hubs we had and how many locations we operated out of. I knew we supported the three main divisions. I knew we had a slew of channels that we processed payments through. But even with some known facts, the devil was in the detail. For example, I knew the dollar value of the budget that I thought I was accountable for, but it wasn't clear which line items within it I was accountable. The next category of facts was the best guess category. I had roughly 1,500 people working for me, but even something which at face value should be really easy as counting FTEs was tricky. Some countries included overtime in their calculations, others didn't. Some countries worked 7.5 hour days, others worked 8.5 hour days. Some countries tried to hide FTEs to avoid the headcount haircut. That's not to mention anything to do with the revolving door of people that were going from job to job constantly. It was just a moving feast. We could never really get to grips with how many people we actually had in this business. In addition, no one could really tell me how many systems were required to run the payments environment, but it was a lot. More than 100 was the most common answer. In terms of how many payment customers we had, well, the bank as a whole had more than 9 million. And so I figured it's hard to be a customer of a bank and not send payments. So that was how many payments customers we had. The product register was different. It depended on who you spoke to. But we thought we were responsible for every payment product apart from card-based products. So that was something. And then finally, we had the no idea category. We had no service catalog, no register of what we were delivering to customers. We had folder after folder, filing cabinet after filing cabinet filled with process maps, but no classification scheme, no library. We had the same effective process was documented in multiple ways with old, out-of-date data, different levels of abstraction and perspectives, and they just weren't used. We had no metrics other than the financial, people, and risk metrics. No throughput rates, no defect rates, no cycle times. Even something as basic as volumes. I asked, just after I arrived, I asked my head of Australian payments how many payments we'd processed yesterday. And his answer was, all of them. And so I could have forgiven him had he been right. So the message here is, you know, be careful about the assumptions you make, particularly when it comes to process maturity. I've read so many papers recently that assume organizations have ERP systems, workflow and business process aware information systems, process engineers, process owners, BPMN models. It's not always the case. So with our team sort of basically having passed through the control phase, it was now time to unleash the process engineers and get into the simplify phase. And that was the program I originally intended to roll out sort of 12 to 14 months earlier. The revised plan, I used to call it the stairway to heaven. It's basically because it's how we laid out the structure of what we were asking the teams to do. Excuse me. And all I wanted them to do was to basically answer the following questions. What's our purpose? Who are our customers? What services do we provide for them? What processes deliver those services? Who owns the process? Have we documented those processes? How do you measure them? What goes wrong? How do you monitor them? How do you choose what to work on and to improve? So nothing too dramatic here. We planned to assess them on a 5-point scale, which was our maturity model. But in reality, based on a conversation I had with Alan Betts from Warwick Business School, we figured that no bank in the world was beyond a level 3, so we only detailed what success looked like for the first 3 levels. And anyone approaching level 3, we intended to review by conducting an ADRI assessment where we evaluated team's maturity based on its approach, how it deployed its program, the results it achieved, and how they intended to improve it. In reality, we had no process engineers to actually help me implement this. No one trained in BPM, no one who'd implemented a process improvement. The process improvement program before. We had a hiring freeze in place, so I couldn't recruit any. The quality of our process documentation was so poor that it was typically out of date, different tools and standards across the countries, so we didn't have a base to work from. There was very little awareness of the tool sets typically deployed in a process improvement environment, other than some basic spreadsheets. There was a limited understanding of a few Lean Six Sigma tools, but that was about it. I had no budget. And on top of that, I'd now sort of grown my number of stakeholders, and I had 5 bosses. I had 5 divisional chief operating officers that I notionally reported into. I had a group chief operating officer who took it upon himself to ring me and shout at me when things went wrong, and a raft of other business stakeholders, all with competing and conflicting objectives, telling me what to do. So the question is, how do you improve processes when you have no one in the team with the right skills, no artifacts or tools, limited capability, no money, and your priorities are changing more frequently than the weather? Well, despite my pleas for additional resources and funding falling on deaf ears, we finally got our process improvement program underway. So this was now, funnily enough, I created a revised plan. And we referred to it as the quality program. We couldn't use words like productivity or efficiently directly as it was associated with job losses. But what we know is that nothing bad happens if you focus on quality. So I had to cut my coat to suit my cloth and develop a plan that I could basically train my team on what they needed to know to get started on an improvement journey. Without the process engineers to make step changes in critical processes, I needed every one of the 1,500 FTEs to make small continuous improvements. And so I ran a series of train-the-trainer programs in problem solving, FMEAs, A3s, and capacity management, and then created a standard improvement pathway for them to follow, which is basically stop all non-value-adding work, consolidate, sweep like things into piles, standardize, so we've got one way, same way of doing things, and then simplify, just take out all the waste and all the duplication. And this is what I wanted the teams to work on. I'm sure many of you on this call will be sort of familiar with similar steps to that, and you'll know that following on from those steps, you typically go into process redesign, automation, outsource, offshoring, if you tend to do that, and then transformation as being the sort of the final steps in the improvement pathway. What we knew was we just didn't have those skills to sort of undertake those final steps, but we still had a long way to go to get to them, and I could worry about where I was going to source those resources from at a future point in time. So we're all good to go. The reality, once again, is not quite as simple. trying to get 1500 people to understand what you want to achieve when you're coming from such a low level of process maturity, especially when they're not aware that they're at a low level of maturity, is really, really hard. It's not always easy to see a vision. And so we had to, what I call, tangibilize the intangible. And we did this by building a command center to provide a tangible vision of what we were trying to achieve. So this was to monitor and control the flow of our payments. It's a large room, it had about 40 screens covering a single wall, and our most experienced SMEs set up to monitor the flow and run any major business continuity events or incidents we had. It covered all aspects of our core payments processing, the environment that we were operating in. So for example, we tracked the sort of the weather and the cyclones coming across the Pacific to make sure that we weren't sort of caught out in our Manila processing center having to close. We could tell when we were at risk of missing cutoffs because of our sort of activity monitoring we had in place, and we knew when our competitors were having systems issues. But it was also about demonstrating the new techniques. It was about demonstrating what statistical process control really means in a practical sense, what visual control means, what business activity monitoring can do to help you, why you'd use simulation modeling. And it was there as a beacon on the hill, well ahead of where the wider team were at that point in time, but something tangible to aim for. So that was one thing we built. But as fast as I could create capacity, finance were taking it away from me. I was asking the run teams to improve processes on top of their day jobs. And whenever we created space and time for them to focus on improvement, finance would come along with a new target and the resources disappeared. To add to the fun, we were doing the pathway in the wrong order. We already had offshoring programs underway, transformation programs underway, and robotics programs underway. You know, we had sort of 50 odd bots that were deployed, but we didn't get any benefit from them because the environment was just so fragmented. This was about 2014, I think, that when we first started to deploy bots. The countries we were working with were all at different start points. Some were pretty sophisticated with relatively high levels of automation. But others, such as in the Pacific Islands, they were still receiving salary files to process on floppy disks. I'm not quite sure whether I mentioned we had no budget. And finally, we operated what we called a three-legged stool model from a resiliency perspective. So for all of our core processes in major markets, we spread the work over three hub locations where it was allowed. Not every country allowed us to do that. And what happened is if you lost one location, then the other two locations only had to pick up, you know, 16% each, rather than having to pick up 50% of the work. But it raised lots of cultural challenges and communication issues, especially when you're trying to choreograph time-critical processes minutes before cutoff in a business continuity event scenario. And the message here was, it doesn't have to be complex. Anyone visiting a Toyota plant would know that the frontline workers are trained in basic problem-solving skills only. They don't have advanced sort of, you know, process engineering skills under their belt. I remember doing a site visit to Virginia Mason Hospital in Seattle 12 years or so ago now. And they'd embraced Lean very early on in the 2000s. And they used to send their senior medical staff, I think it was to Hitachi, to work on the production line in Japan. There was no English spoken or written, yet they were fully productive in a matter of hours. It was outstanding to see. And really, that was the heart of our simplification program. And I'll come on to the results of it later. The next step was automation. Now, I was constantly challenged by stakeholders saying, well, why don't you just automate it? And you know, the plan all along was to automate. You know, in payments, it's called straight-through processing, or STP. And every payments business wants to straight-through process. The vast majority of payments in a major bank are fully automated. But those that aren't tend to represent significant risk, and they tend to be low-volume, high-value payments going cross-border or settling sort of between the banks. And, you know, they can be multi-billion-dollar payments. And, you know, from an outsider's perspective, or even someone in a different team in the bank, they say, well, a payment is a payment is a payment. They all follow the same process. You've automated some. Why can't you automate all of them? And the reality is that the environment that processes payments in most mature banks resembles a plate of spaghetti. It's a tangled mess of legacy applications, process fragments, and manual workarounds. My team had over 8,500 sets of work instructions to process payments for 32 countries. You know, there are multiple channels. Many of them are not electronic. Some countries prefer to send payments via manual channels like fax. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of process variants, especially where corporates and institutional customers are involved. As I mentioned earlier, there were over 100 applications involved, some over 30 years old, many with green screens, mainframe applications, expensive to change with limited change windows. Workflow is limited and partially implemented, and there may be regulatory enforced manual steps. So automating isn't easy. And as I mentioned earlier, we did sort of quite a lot of robotics very early on. But not only did we not get any benefit or any yield from those early stage robotic implementations, we actually made the operating environment significantly more complex, and the increasing risk was substantial. It only takes a mainframe team to swap a buy and a sell field round on a green screen legacy application without informing the bots team, and that they had no reason to. They worked in different countries, in different locations, in different teams, and they would never normally talk to each other. And you've significantly increased your financial risk. And with things like, you know, when we were developing our first stage machine learning and AI algorithms, you know, for some processes, we need to demonstrate to a regulator how we actually arrived at a decision. A response based on probability, or one where the computer said no because it's some deep learning configuration with no audit trail, just isn't going to cut it. I think I may have mentioned this before, but I had no money. And most importantly, and the reason sort of which I kept coming back to about, you know, why we hadn't tried to automate right at the start was, there was a different team that had been assigned to automating our payments processing environment. The little beetle, by the way, is my reference to Kafka's Metamorphosis, because just be careful what you wish for with transformation. It's a beast of a thing to deal with. And when I started, I mentioned that the transformation was already underway, and a colleague had been assigned to sort of to lead the systems part of the transformation. We were both marched into the group chief operating officer's office, and we were left in no doubt that we were jointly accountable for delivering this transformation. And I left that particular room feeling pretty despondent, because my colleague had all the money, all the resources, he was doing all the sexy stuff, he was doing the sort of the implementing real-time payments, doing the blockchain, presenting to the board, etc. And I was left to get shouted at when things went wrong. So I was feeling pretty put out by this, and I had no idea why I was accountable for transformation when clearly there's nothing I didn't just have the resources to do the automation. But the critical part was about how we worked together. Because he had all the money and all the resources, I got my agenda done through him. I leveraged his team to get the process engineers. I got them to set up the APQC classification. I got them to fund specific automation initiatives that would really help. I made sure that our processes were documented and modeled in a standard way. I seconded my team into the transformation project so that they didn't feel as threatened by it. And also they could pass on their experience of what was really happening now, as opposed to leveraging the sort of the process models that had been written 3 years ago when they were doing the as is. And by working as closely together as possible, we actually delivered a much better outcome. And so the message from this was, you know, what needs to be done may seem obvious, but the path to get there isn't always the direct one. And, you know, there were also a whole bunch of other challenges, and I've got no way of telling a story, so I just thought I'd sort of just put them out there. First one, you know, banks are big places. Many of the bank examples you see cited in papers, journals, or by consultants will represent just a part of the bank. It may be the mortgage process or the account opening or KYC process of the bank that's been referred to, that's at the cutting edge. And it may very well be, but it's highly likely that the rest of the bank isn't. I mean, indeed, in my experience, every division, country, function just have their own tools, their own techniques, their own frameworks, their own language that they use. It's like a Tower of Babel. You'll have arguments about whether we should Signavio versus Visio, or someone will lob in, but we do all our process mapping in PowerPoint or Excel. Then you'll have discussions about whether we're going to just use simple flowcharts or BPMN. Are we going to use APQC, or are we going to use the Accenture and IBM's capability models? Is it Six Sigma, or is it Lean that we're going to follow? It is just so wearing having these conversations that seem to go nowhere. But how can you standardize processes across a large organization if you don't have a standard governance framework in place? The next area was process ownership, and assigning process ownership, when you stand back, just seems, well, it can't be that hard, but it is so incredibly contentious in many banks. When everything's going well, every process has dozens of owners. When it's not going well, you'd be hard pushed to find a single process owner. Everybody's blaming everybody else. Even the decision around single point of accountability versus joint accountability is contentious. During a particular ferocious debate on this point, where the senior leader wanted the delightful one throat to choke, they were asked by a colleague, "Who's accountable for bringing up your children? You or your husband?" The conversation fell silent for what seemed like an eternity. It was a painful, painful few minutes. Another example is around the context. The Australian financial regulator introduced a banking executive accountability regime, or BEAR for short. And it was essentially to hold senior executives in banks more accountable. The senior leaders in one bank, when they were trying to understand the implications of BEAR, they decided to role play a payment systems outage scenario, one that led to significant losses and customer impact. So the conversation went along the lines of, it's clearly the CIO's fault, they're in charge of the systems. But the CIO said, I've been telling the business owner that it was going to fail for years. The business owner says, yes, it's been on the investment prioritization list for the last 5 years, but still hasn't been approved. The CFO then says, but the investment program is full and the investment committee didn't prioritize it. So who's accountable here? And there are more practical examples. So even if you do have a clear process owner, it doesn't mean to say they can get stuff done. You've got a process owner, but they may want to work on an asset that's got a different technology asset owner that only has two release cycles a year on a mainframe asset, and the backlog extends out to 2023. You're just going to go onto the back of the backlog. Or you've got a channel owner who wants to make their channel look and feel different from a customer experience perspective, and your little field validation change just isn't going to get onto the schedule. The next area is about variation, and I've talked a little bit about variation already, but it really is, it's the devil incarnate in financial services. In one country, basically every corporate and commercial client had their own bespoke fee schedule. The cost of maintaining that, training people, the risk was just extraordinary. It's like the sort of whack-a-mole game. Trying to get rid of it is almost impossible. There are many causes. There are change programs that run out of money. So someone says, can you put in a manual workaround to finish it? You've got bankers trying to win deals, and they'll take whatever deal's on offer, even if the processes aren't capable of delivering it. Country variation, shortcuts that individuals have introduced. Just this variation is everywhere. And it's funny, when you get process engineers joining banks from manufacturing, it's really easy to sort of spot them, because they're the ones who always turn out the lights when they leave the room, and they always point out the trip hazards. But they start their banking career thinking that all their Christmases have come at once. They see all this variation, they see the waste. And then 12 months later, they're scratching their heads and they're totally frustrated. And as one said to me, trying to get rid of variation is like trying to catch smoke. Another area which had sort of lots of challenges is risk and controls. I'm particularly interested in process compliance, and one of the reasons is that there are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of requirements aligned to each process. Visualizing this complexity on a process model is almost impossible. Processes don't fail at the process model level of abstraction. They fail in the detail. They fail in the weeds. The vast majority of banking controls are post-execution controls, like reconciliations. For those preemptive controls we have, it tends to be things like a four-eyed check. But a four-eyed check's flawed. If I told you how many payments had failed that had been through not only four eyes, but six eyes or eight eyes, it'd be sort of betraying sort of corporate secrets. In banking, so many processes tend to be hidden, buried away in data centers, But because they're not fully automated and they keep popping out for a little bit of a manual intervention here and there and everywhere, and then get hidden away again, they're like ticking time bombs. You know, so for example, an account manager can key in the wrong interest rate for a client, and this may not be picked up at the time. An 8 and a 0 can look very much the same on a green screen, especially when the checker is being sort of pulled in different directions and it's close to cutoff. But if you apply that scenario to a sweep account, one where all the sort of the sub accounts are rolled together at the end of the day and interest rates is calculated on the total balance, for a large corporate client with 1,000 sub accounts, and when 4 years later that client detects that they've received the incorrect amount of interest, going back to manually recreate their end of day position over 1,000 accounts for 4 years is an expensive defect. It's not like a chocolate bar factory where you know processes are failing when there's chocolate on the floor. So it's hard to see the real risk in a process model. The trite answer is to design better controls, but there are just so many of them. It's hard to see the wood for the trees, especially when the risk function sees every separate issue as an opportunity for another control. Checkers, checking, checkers, checking, checkers, and not considering the process as a whole, where the objective should be to have the minimum number of controls providing the maximum level of control, obviously within the risk appetite. So controls get duplicated, triplicated, quadruplicated, that's a word, and a response to a code of practice breach may introduce a control to check the depth of queues. A response to a repeated failure to hit SLAs may also lead to a control to check the depth of queues. Essentially controls trying to manage the same risk. And the worst case is that they will be designed differently. The next area is run versus change. As I've mentioned right at the start, in a service process environment like payments, you have to fly the plane and build the plane at the same time. You can't pull the and on cord and stop the production line waiting to find why an operator hadn't checked a single payment correctly when there's billions of dollars worth of payments in a queue and only a few minutes left to process them. It's also difficult when the people at the front line who you want to identify and implement improvement opportunities are essentially doing two jobs. They're doing the run part, which is actually processing the payments, and that will always have their priority. So there's nothing more frustrating than having a group of SMEs in a room working through a really tricky problem, seeing you're making progress, and then they all down tools to respond to some BCP event or business continuity planning event. At the same time, that the change part is not just sort of the team doing their sort of continuous improvement, but it's also the transformation teams and the re-engineers. Keeping both teams aligned is really difficult. You know, they have different time horizons. They've got different objectives, different priorities, different metrics, different remuneration structures, and different views of operational reality. It's really hard to keep those teams aligned. It's like flying through an asteroid belt. Everything is changing around you. Rocks are being hurled at you, whichever way you turn. And at the start of this case study, you know, in 2011, we were in the middle of the euro crisis. We were constantly testing resiliency strategies, receiving minute by minute updates on our assessments of which banks might fail, what our exposure was, how quickly we could drop the payment lines to mitigate risk. And then out of the blue, we'd have a systems outage. A cyclone would hit one of our processing centers. A senior exec would demand we drop everything to get a report together on progress. And your team are racing to complete their compliance training to avoid performance penalties. Managing both is really, really tricky. And the last area is politics and organizational change. And this is an extraordinarily difficult area. I was restructured every 12 to 18 months. My team size varied from 8 to 1,500 people. But I still had exactly the same accountability. Sometimes they reported directly to me, sometimes they didn't, and it just changed every 12 to 18 months. We had changes of CEOs, new strategies, competing agenda, recruitment freezes, travel bans, projects prioritized, approved, and then canceled. You know, it's really hard to run a multi-year program when you have so much change and so many things outside of your control impacting that agenda. But for all that, and despite all the challenges, you know, it was an extraordinarily competent team. They were so good at what they did. As I mentioned, we referred to it as a quality program. So the primary metric we used was a quality metric. And for those of you familiar with the SANDCON model, you'll know that if you want to increase agility and reduce cost, you have to start with quality. But quality was something our people wanted to get behind. No one wanted to do a bad job. Everybody wanted to improve quality. And the results you can see on the screen here were published in the bank's sort of results that were shared every half for five halves running. And, you know, needless to say, there was a great impact on customers, there was a great impact on risk, and also a great impact on our overall productivity from delivering those sorts of quality results. At the same time, one of the things I was trying to get the teams to do was to really empower them to go and run their own show and to work through their improvement program at their own pace, because I said they all had different starting points. So we had to make the metrics really, really simple. And one of the key ones is that we had an overall organization mantra of simplification, hence my second phase was called Simplify. But no one had defined what complexity meant. So I wanted it to be easy. I wanted it to be something that teams could do themselves. And so basically all we said was, well, take your process map or process model and multiply the number of steps by the number of handoffs, by the number of decisions or gateways, by the number of systems that are used and the number of variants. And that's your as is process complexity number. Now go away and halve it. And you know the logic behind is obviously if you reduce the number of steps or reduce the handoffs or reduce the decisions or reduce the number of systems involved and reduce the number of variants, you're making things easier. It's pretty straightforward. And you see some of those other metrics we've also talked about, but it really made people very focused. There were also a number of results which can't necessarily document, but there's an industry survey which is compiled by FI Metrics, and that rated ANZ as world-class for its Aussie dollar and Kiwi dollar payments clearing. Our straight-through processing rates went to market-leading in Australia and New Zealand. Our staff engagement rose significantly, and we had the highest internal audit rating for any operational team. And for a payments business, that's pretty unusual. So we were delighted with the results. You know, we sort of delivered the business case benefits for the payments transformation, sort of, you know, well ahead of the payments transformation completing. But what I thought I'd sort of really sort of come to, start to get towards a close on was this presentation started with me saying I had a plan to implement the BPM lifecycle, or at least a version of it. So how did I go? Well, what I realized in hindsight was that the BPM lifecycle wasn't particularly helpful for someone responsible for run and change. My first step was to identify the processes. Having done a similar job before, I pretty much knew what they were, so I just had a few questions to ask to make sure that a bit of a reality check. But that's when we started to deviate from the BPM lifecycle. And you know what I found was that the BPM lifecycle sees monitoring and control as the last stage in the cycle, whereas I see it as the first. Very few people who start a new job get a clean sheet of paper. Processes are already in flight, and the time taken to discover them, whether it's with traditional methods or process mining methods, is too long if you're accountable for the day-to-day, because you can lose your job within a day. If it goes dramatically wrong, you have to get into seeing what's actually happening on the ground, on the floor, before you sort of take yourself off to a room to start analyzing processes. And what I observed was that for most of my team, the vast majority of my team, they spent their time and effort executing and monitoring individual process instances. And all the team members were really sort of concerned with was, do I need to intervene? Do I just let the process flow and we do what was documented, what our work instructions say? Or do I need to escalate to a supervisor? Do I need to do something differently? So that was their only real consideration. And this was really about sort of managing instance control. When I then sort of looked at what our team leaders and managers do, they essentially do the same thing, but for the overall flow. They're looking for, they're monitoring multiples of individual payments and individual transactions, and then making that same call. Do I intervene or do I just let it go? And the level of abstraction is really important, because I may choose not to intervene for a one-off minor violation, but if the minor violation occurs in multiple cases, I may choose to intervene. So an example is, someone's skipping a check on a $50 payment close to cutoff is not good, but I may choose to let it go given it's only 50 bucks and we're very close to sort of missing our service level for the day. But if it were a $5 million payment, or there were repeated instances of an operator skipping a step close to cutoff, then I may choose to intervene. And as I think I alluded to right at the very start, the biggest gap in the life cycle for me is the integration of capacity control. You know, I don't know enough about BPM theory, but I can't think of a service process that I would take over where I wouldn't look at capacity management first. And you know, you can't run a process without understanding capacity management. And I've, you know, it's very, you know, most of the environments I've worked in, I can find 15 to 25% capacity within 12 weeks without changing the process, just by helping people sort of deploy resources in a more balanced way across the demand profile. And once you've freed up the time, you can then get them to focus on the core processes. What typically happens is the team's overwhelmed, they're stressed, they're doing overtime, and someone comes in from outside, a consultant, a process engineer, and the first thing they do is ask the team to do more work. And they don't get a warm reception, let me tell you. So this is essentially the run part of the business. I don't know any operational managers that would use a process model to conduct this part of their business. But when it comes to interventions, well, you know, not all interventions are the same. Some are very simple, like if you've got a new hire who doesn't understand a particular transaction type, and a short in the moment coaching intervention is all that's required to get them sort of back up and running again. Others may need a fail fix approach. You might need to swap out a SanDisk in the service data center, or reboot a laptop, or reload a static data file. But for this type of change, no one looks at the process model. The level of analysis is essentially a triage process. You've got minutes to make a decision. Time is of the essence, and I'm not going to do sort of into the filing cabinet to dig out a process model, then get a bunch of people to go and analyze it when I've got subject matter experts who know exactly how it works and know what the root cause is. One of the key lessons we learned from Toyota and Lean, though, is that those closest to the work are the ones to ask about what to improve and how to do it. And this is where the core of the life cycle does come into play. But they need a simplified version. They haven't got time to go and learn, you know, complex techniques, complex tools. This is the doing process improvement off the side of their desk. This is not their day job. Their day job is to process work, not necessarily to change work, but because they understand where all the issues are, they're very well placed to sort of to make those small changes. And of course, when you get onto large change, when you get onto enterprise-wide re-engineering and transformation, then that is absolutely the heartland of the life cycle. And you need the right skills, the right resources, right tools, the right techniques, et cetera, to be deployed to make this work. So change for me is a combination of fail fix, team-based problem solving, and sort of cross-functional change. And that completes the change part of the agenda. But what's interesting is that most of the change is actually undertaken by the run team and not the change team. And there's plenty of research that alludes to the disappointment most businesses experience with transformative change. Now, there's an Oliver Wyman survey out at the moment which reports that only 25% of investors are confident that banking transformation strategies will be effective. So the key message is, you know, to recognize the difference between run and change. Not only the activities are different, but more importantly, who does them? And more specifically, given how much change is undertaken by the run team, that the tools, frameworks, and methodologies that are applied by the run team need to be easy to understand and easy to implement, but they need to complement those of the change team. So what does industry need? In simple terms, as hopefully you picked up from that last sort of couple of slides, is more help for the run team and not just the change team. Make the run team's life easier. Make it easier for them to identify and implement improvement opportunities, particularly around reducing complexity. So finding solutions to consolidate variants. You know, when you discover a process model from an event log and you're faced with a plate of spaghetti, what do? The outliers compose the greatest risk, but we don't want to abstract them or ignore them because they're the ones I need to identify to play and win the whack-a-mole game. I need to make it easier to see and navigate complexity and understand what's driving it. You know, it's easy to see the branching point in the process, but why is it branching? What are the attributes about that case that creates the branching path? You know, for all the outlying cases, summarizing what is unique about them would be really helpful. I need to make it easier to visualize risk within a process and the impact of the controls have on the overall design. Most controls, you know, can be implemented as an XL gateway, but each process can have several hundred controls, so you can't see the wood for the trees if you do that. We need improved ontologies, taxonomies, filtering, simplified control design notation, common objects like the, you know, decision-making notation, just to try and make it easy to bring risk to life. We need to develop techniques for assessing the impact of controls, models that have controls added constantly to them. It makes the underlying model cluttered, they're duplicated, often conflicting and expensive. So we need techniques for visualizing the waste and excising it. You know, what's the cost of each control? What's the risk versus benefit trade-off in terms of improved cycle times and defect rates from a reduction in controls? How can I get the maximum amount of control at the minimum cost? And as discussed numerous times during this presentation, we need to know how can we integrate capacity management into process models? You can't run a process without understanding it. For example, how can I capture demand profiles or calculate resource requirements for line balancing? How can I distinguish between a bottleneck that's caused by a simple human resource constraint, and I can just basically go reassign them to another task, versus any other type of constraint? You know, there's lots of work in the academic community going on around predictive and prescriptive monitoring, but this is a real opportunity to be the expert support, the expert decision maker to support operational leaders. You know, if you've got 30 minutes to go to cut off 50 people in a team, and a check takes 2 minutes per payment, I've got a capacity of 750 payments, but there's 1500 in the queue. What am I going to do? Am I going to breach SLA cutoffs? Am I not going to do the check? We need support to make that easier rather than relying on the skills and experience of the individual operators. And finally, as I mentioned at the start, ops managers and their teams in banking don't use process models as part of their day-to-day role. We need to change that, not only to help make the run part of their jobs easier, but to ensure the flow between run and change is seamless, that they're effectively using the same toolkit, albeit maybe a stripped down or a simpler version for those team members working in the run team. You know, why can't I incorporate wireframes of customer screens as a model overlay to help visualize the customer experience? Why can't I have process models that help visualize and simplify what happens when an operation switches from business as usual to business continuity mode and back again? Why can't my online monitoring flag variations as an instance run and derive a critical checklist for an instance to execute flawlessly? Where's my heads-up display? Why can't I have a simple way to create realistic and accurate simulations that I can use to train my leaders in decision-making? You know, there are so many opportunities to actually introduce or to make process models and the underlying techniques more valuable for these runtime leaders. Now, the big four Australian banks spend between $4 and $5 billion a year on projects. It's not hard to estimate that they probably spend between $500 million and $1 billion a year on process discovery, or doing the as-is part of that. And they've been spending that every year since I've been in banking. So why aren't the models created once and then continuously updated? Why are there different models for different teams? Organizations need both continuous improvement and transformative change to succeed. So keeping the two aligned is essential. And the BPM toolkit should be at the heart of that alignment, but today it's too heavily skewed towards the re-engineering transformative side of the ledger. So in short, we have to make BPM a critical resource for runtime leaders. And finally, I get that the sort of primary metric in academia is about publishing papers, but find time to connect with industry. Build your network. It doesn't have to be a funded collaboration. Even a few trusted colleagues in different industry sectors, just to bounce ideas off. You know, you never know where you might find the inspiration for your next paper. And also put yourselves in their shoes. You know, imagine you just published a significant paper and a major corporate has headhunted you to implement your ideas, and your remuneration is based on a successful implementation. You know, what would you do differently? What challenges would you face? How would you deal with these challenges? Trying to factor these types of what-ifs into the final paper, I feel will be sort of a, you know, significant step forward. And finally, a quote from a Scottish poet, which I'll translate into: the best laid plans of mice and men often go awry. You know, you have to have a plan, but the environment you're operating in is changing so fast, you always need to be agile and prepared to pivot. So thank you. And at that point, I'll be open for any questions.
Thank you, Nigel, for the nice talk. So it's very interesting. We touched on a lot of challenges. So I would like at this point to start the question and answer part. We already have a question in the chat. Now I would just remind the attendees that if you would like to speak, you can just use the Zoom function to raise your hand and I will allow you to speak. If you prefer to write your question, you can either use the question and answer chat box. You can open it from the bottom bar in Zoom, or you can also type in the chat. We will be able to see the answer, the question. So let's start with the first question. This is from Bernhard. Which models are more relevant for runtime leaders? What kind of model for whom? Any example?
Well, it's an interesting one because the models tend to say at the moment, most of the models tend to be sort of used from a change perspective when you want to change a process. Where I've seen models being really effectively used is simulation models. So whether that's using sort of a process mining log for playback or just to demonstrate the impact of variation to leaders. So one of the models we used to build as part of our training was an extraordinarily simple iGraphic simulation of a maker checker process, just to show the impact of variation of work content time or processing time for a payment and the impact that had on cost, plus the impact of the inter-arrival rate, i.e. the demand profile. And, you know, my question would be, if an individual can process 10 payments per day and there are 100 payments to process, how many people do you need in the team? And of course, everybody would say, well, I need 10. And I'd say, well, that's the only number that's probably wrong. You might need 9.9, you might need 10.1, but you know you won't need 10 because you won't have A, 10 payments per day because you can never guarantee it, and B, a person can't produce 10 payments a day. So using simulation models to actually highlight the impact of variation is critical. Business activity monitoring was what we introduced into our command center. The limitation on that for me, though, is it's not process aware. So I could see all my queues all sort of piled up, but I didn't know where they were coming from and where they were going to. And so introducing sort of a discovered process and then allowing sort of transactions to flow through it as part of my visual control would be something, you know, extraordinarily useful, I think, is where I'd start with that.
Okay, we have, thanks, Nigel. We have another question from Bernhard again. Are these guidance or steering or advice or evaluation models mentioning?
The ones I've just talked about are basically sort of their guidance and their training. What we're seeing a lot of the banks do at the moment is they're particularly using sort of artificial intelligence and machine learning to help actually sort of manage cases as cases come through. And I think I mentioned that there's obviously a lot of research going into both predictive and prescriptive monitoring. And I think they're both highly, highly valuable. So the two things for me, which would, if I went back into running my team now, which I would want, is I would absolutely want predictive monitoring. I want to know how many payments are going to miss cutoff. I want to know which controls I'm going to breach and what the impact of those controls are. I'd settle for that. I prefer not only to have the predictions, but also suggested next best action to follow. And so I haven't seen sort of too many of those in a payments environment. That as I said, because of the number of applications, they're typically quite tricky to model. And I've been very, very disappointed with all the simulation models I've seen in banking. The only, you know, one of the few ones I've seen that worked really, really well was for a mailroom. Because the other processes are just, you know, if watching someone try to model a mortgage process is a thing of beauty, because it's just so frustrating for them to try to get it right. It's so complex.
Thanks again, Nigel. So I don't see any question in the chat.
Yeah. Adriano, I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
Hi, Marcello.
Hi. Thank you for the very interesting presentation. One thing that really sort of got my attention was the stark contrast from, on the one hand, the fact that you didn't have any budget at all, and on the other hand, the strong sense of urgency that was put on you and the high attention on the topic from the executives.
Yep.
Why was that so? Where did things go wrong for this to happen?
Well, it's a beautiful form of torture that only large corporates can sort of inflict on people, sort of Marcello. So if you'd have asked that question to the group chief operating officer, he'd said, you've got $70 million a year to change the processes. But that was all sitting with my colleague in transformation. My targets were about cost reduction. I had no money to actually to execute cost reduction. I just had to do it out of my natural skill and knowledge. So any projects I had, they had to be self-funding, which is why I was so focused on freeing up capacity, because that was my currency to free up resources to go and focus on the things I wanted to do. Now, as I said, I learned very quickly, and my colleague that was running the large systems part of the change was very generous and magnanimous and worked very well with me, but he had the money. But in terms of manually transferring the money from him to me, that, you know, the finance guys just wouldn't let that happen. So, and it was just, it's different accountabilities. You know, I wouldn't want to be mean, but, you know, the transformation's still going over 10 years. You know, we delivered all the business benefits back in 2015 from a cost perspective. So it just, you know, I think that's just one of those forms of corporate torture that you sort of end up having to deal with.
Thank you.
But it was actually sort of much. It was really interesting, as I said, because it's that, you know, you're only as good as yesterday's sort of success. And, you know, the chief operating officer, we could have a payment miss in the Pacific, and he would ring me up about it. And that's why he was very focused on getting that quality program numbers into the half yearly and the annual reports, because he wanted something to show that we were doing this and it wasn't costing us any money. You know, it was a proof point for him to sort of to do a bit of bragging rights around his peers.
And would have made any difference instead of being a cost center, it was on the revenue center, like showing how you could help them with improving the revenue. So this was under cost center because it was payment, right? That is.
Yes. So it's part of a business, typically part of a business called transaction banking. And when I joined, it had sat within transaction banking, or as close to it as possible. And just after I joined, there was a restructure, and it moved out to be like the chief operating officer's role was formed. Operations and technology came together, so it was a pure cost. So we didn't have any offsets. Had it sat still with the revenue generating business, the cost reduction targets would have been far less, and the initiatives we were implementing would have been much more focused on quality from a customer experience perspective, as opposed to quality from just saving defects so I can free up capacity. And banks just go through that sort of cycling from centralized to decentralized, back into the business, back into a central operation. They go through that and every 2 or 3 years.
Thanks.
Okay, we have another question in the chat from Mahendra Wati. Thank you again for the presentation, Nigel. And it seems that you have a lot of challenges in this case study, but what do you see in the end as the main success factors?
Oh, it has to be the people. I mean, just an outstanding team of people. You know, I started this by saying, well, they didn't have skills in, you know, process management, etc. But my job was really to, you know, say to show them what success looked like, empower them, train them on a few tools, a few techniques, and then just get out of the way. Now, that was culturally very challenging because, you know, in certain sort of Asian cultures, like when I'd go to our Chengdu site, there is an expectation that the senior leader has all the answers. And I would turn up to a team meeting with them and I'd say, you know, so what are you going to do about this? And they'd look at me saying, well, don't you know? And I said, I've got no idea. I'm miles away from the work. I haven't processed a payment in years. Why would I know what to do? And this was really confronting. So creating an environment where you had a team that felt confident, that had the enough skills and techniques to make a difference, and then you just unleashed them. So that was one of the big things. And that was the most rewarding part, just to see how the team sort of grew from that perspective. But the other part, just sort of going back to almost like Marcello's question, was that ability to work really collaboratively with the change team. Now, lots of transformations I've seen fail because they didn't have that in place. So there were a huge amount of mechanics that I would put in place, like who was on different working groups, how we mix those, how we design the steering committees, how we make sure we have the show and tell so that the change team would come onto production floor to see what was happening today, not what they saw, you know, 3 years ago when they did their as-is modeling, etc. And so, and we worked extraordinarily hard to get the alignment between the transformation team, the change team, and the run team to build up mutual trust. You know, the guys that were in the ops team to start with, you know, they just expected to, they knew the transformation was going ahead. They just thought they were all going to lose their jobs. And so why should I get involved and answer all the questions that will help me lose my job? And so trying to sort of overcome that barrier was challenging. Now, you know, so the underlying mechanics, the tools, as I say, they were pretty straightforward. You know, the command center was my plaything. That, you know, is highly visible. We used that to win business. You know, we had JP Morgan and Citibank and Barclays and a whole raft of other banks who would we do clearing business for, and they would come and say, this is better than anything we've seen in our banks. But it was my plaything because that sort of kept me entertained in terms of applying some of the more sort of, you know, complex techniques that I'd seen elsewhere, but just the broader team weren't ready to deploy. So three or four different things.
But the problem is again related to budget, Nigel.
Yeah.
Because if the only way you had to create your own budget was by reducing the headcount, then this led to this effect on people. They didn't want to fully disclose where the problems were, what was the actual reality, because they were afraid of losing their job.
Right. So this is where there's you know, I'll probably give myself a pat on the back for boxing clever here, as the phrase goes. So with my friend in the change team who had just, you know, tens of millions of dollars every year, every time I was asked to reduce headcount, I would just go and chat to him and tell him how important these people were. We can't lose these people, so maybe he should fund them. And I just moved them into that team. And so they still work for me, but they worked in a different team on paper by a different sort of, you know, different line item. When I built the command center, you know, if I'd have put a business case up for that, it would still be waiting for approval. But we just happened to be changing offices. So I convinced the real estate guys to build me a data wall. And I used budgets. We had a budget that was there for sort of improving payment metrics. And I siphoned off a lot of that to get BAM going through it. And so I just took money from other pockets and pools of money where I could. And so I guess that was my sort of crafty little bit to get things done.
So we have another question in the chat from Stephen. One of the processes you presented that run teams were conducting was something called the capacity planning. How was the capacity planned for process instances? What did the capacity consist of? Was that somehow supported by BPM?
So capacity management is a process, obviously, but it's a support process. And this is really wanting to make sure that we have enough resources to run a process at any future period in time. And it's a very simple cycle. You start with forecasting how much work there is coming in, and you do that over different time horizons from, you know, intraday, how much work's coming in every 10 minutes or every hour, every day of the week, every week of the month, every month of the year. So you've got different time horizons, and once you know what your demand profile looks like, you then can start to plan your resources to make sure you've just got just the right amount of resources to deliver that amount of work at the right people, the right time, with the right skills. And the only thing we know is that demand will be different. So how you flex your capacity up and down to adjust to demand is what makes it so challenging. Now, we used a range of different capacity planning tools, but the main resources we were planning for was people. Because, you know, for example, we could get to a stage where an hour before our cutoffs were coming for the day's end, had payments banked up in a queue, and they were all waiting to be sanction screened. I just had to pick up the phone to the team in sort of Bangalore and say, you know, get all the sanctions guys out of the lunchroom. It's time to start processing payments. So we you know, you can redeploy capacity in that sense. But it's not just people. We process a lot of pension payments for European governments, where European governments are making pension payments to their former citizens in Australia. And a couple of those countries, you know, it's very, very large files of payments coming through. And one file, our throughput capacity from a systems perspective couldn't cope with the size of the file. So we had to chop the file up and break it into four batches that were released every 15 to 30 minutes throughout the day. So you have to look at systems capacity. You have to look at resource capacity. Another really strange one, when we started to introduce all of our bots, we were doing them off desktop computers. And basically each bot had its own desktop computer on its own desk. These were running out of our Bangalore center, where it was an absolute sort of, you know, space was a premium. Space was very expensive. I'd have five operators sitting at one desk and then another desk with a desktop on it, just waiting for someone to log in and kick the bot off. So, you know, no one had thought about, you know, sort of using virtual bots or even just getting flip-top laptops and sticking them on a wall. So you had sort of capacity from a space perspective. So lots of different ways of looking at capacity. But as I said, you know, for most banks and most clerical processes, it is done extraordinarily badly because you're given a budget allocation by finance to say you can have 20 people in your team. So someone thinks, well, I need 20 people. But there are times during the day or during the week or during the year when you might only need three. And then there are times you need 12. How do you adjust it? And so bringing that to life, because you can't see that in a process model. It's really, really hard. I mean, clearly you can see it when, you know, you can see if a particular task is or an activity is backed up. But you don't know whether that's just because you haven't allocated resources appropriately or because the work content of that task is particularly arduous, or there's some other holdup within the process that's not related to resource allocation.
Thanks, Nigel. So we have last few minutes. I would say I think we probably managed to answer the last question in the chat. So once again, Kunam, thanks you for the inspiring talk. And then he asks, can you describe internal interactions inside the RAN team? For example, people who performing core business activities in the field, like knowledge worker, and people who are maintaining systems or managing business processes, like system administrators or business managers. Also, what can help such interaction inside the RAN team?
That's such a good question, because so in any large organization, it's very easy to get these silos, these fiefdoms, and people don't talk to each other. I had a team where there was one particular operator, and every morning he was just in a bad mood. And, you know, everybody in the team was walking on eggshells because this one individual was always in a bad mood. And after a couple of weeks of this, I went up and asked him, I said, why are you in such a bad mood? And he said, I've been sat next to that guy for the last 3 years and I can't stand him. So even people sitting next to each other just don't communicate with each other. So communication is not something that naturally occurs, and you have to intervene and force it to happen. So one area where we did was in our command center. I had a blended team in there. I had teams from tech, I had teams from operations, I had teams from, like, so the change, the process change type people, all working together. Now, sometimes it was like a skeleton team, and then when we had a major systems outage or a major incident, everybody would flood to the same point, so you had the right resources together. But even, outside of the command center, we did whatever was possible to co-locate people. And obviously virtually, given teams are sort of located across multiple ways. So you have to work really hard at it. And what I encourage teams to do is just to walk in someone else's shoes. Everybody's got a hard job. But if you only think about how hard your job is and not how hard someone else's job is, you end up fighting. And so you need to see it from a different perspective. And as I mentioned earlier, if I wanted to get something done, you know, if I didn't have a good relationship with the systems owner or the systems engineers or the product owner, it would just take me forever. Whereas because I was connecting, communicating with them, and I could find ways to get, you know, to work with them on a very human level, I managed to get stuff snuck in that probably would have had to wait for a very long time.
Thanks, Nigel. So I would stop here the questions and answer. for everyone who would like to attend the next session of MSAD, you have to leave this webinar and join the next webinar. For the BPMDS attendees, we will have our next session in 45 minutes. I would like to thank you again, Nigel, for the talk and for your time and for being here today. And thanks again for the interesting talk.
That's no problem, Adriana, and I'm more than happy to hang around for a few minutes if anybody's got any additional questions that they would like to hang on to, if, assuming the line's still open.
Yeah, so who is attending MSAD, please move to the next session. Anyone else, if you have still questions, Nigel is here for another few minutes, so feel free to use the chat or raise your hand for talking with Nigel. Thanks.
Well, that's pretty easy.
Okay, someone raised their hand in the chat. Okay, it's Bernard. Bernard, I'm going to allow you to talk. So
yep.
I think if you can now unmute yourself.
Yeah, thanks. Naturally, you have been mainly presenting as a strategic, as tactical and operational framework for management of such things. One thing, however, is also important. That is scoping, focusing as a landscape mode. That means the general politics or something like that, or policy or whatever. How you would characterize, which kind of models you would use in this case?
I'm not quite sure I understood the question, Bernard. So just talk to me. So give me an example of what you would, some of the possible examples you'd expect to see.
The landscaping means in this case, I know what kind of application game I'm playing in the yep. sense of, let's say, Wittgenstein. And then you say, okay, fine. This is my setting, my general focus, my general scope.
Yep.
And now I'm trying to solve something like that. That means in this case, you say, okay, fine. I'm in the banking business. Banking is your environment, your context. And in this case, you have to have some kind of glimpse how to handle this specific context.
So the banks aren't particularly good at this sort of stuff. I mean, they tend to use, the technology guys will want to use either the Accenture or the IBM capability models.
Mm-hmm.
We in Ops, we finally settled on APQC as a process classification framework, but it wasn't really implemented particularly well. When you look at APQC for banking, payments comes in as a process at level three, and there are two processes, inward payments and outward payments. Mm-hmm. And so by the time we'd actually implemented APQC for our true payments environment, we sort of had eight levels in the process hierarchy just to get down to the level that actually made sense for us. So we had to do a lot of work to manipulate it. So it wasn't particularly helpful. Banks would also tend to use their own consultant, the BCGs, the McKinseys of this world, who come in with their flavor of the month. But mm-hmm. from a process perspective, it's they're just not rigorous. They're just not there. As I said, at National Australia Bank, we use the Business Excellence Framework. I'm not quite sure whether that's translates into sort of from a European perspective, but it's very similar to the EQFM model. We use the balanced scorecard model a lot to actually sort of to be able to translate objectives into sort of, to critical success factors, KPIs, but then linking that to process is just a void. It just doesn't happen. And that's, my last activity that I was working on, I was working with an organization called Holocentric to try and build a digital twin, because decisions were being made that had no grounding in reality. So someone would just go and say, you've got to take out 50% of your costs next year. Mm-hmm. Now, you cannot imagine going to an automotive maker and say, you need to take 50% of your costs out. What are you going to do? Not put the engine in? Mm-hmm. And that disconnect with decision-making at an executive level and what happens at a day-to-day level is a real fundamental flaw, I feel. I've spent 15 years tried to figure out why it is the case. You know, if other organizations run their processes the way that banks run them, you know, people would die. But, you know, banks are funny things, you know, and one of the conclusions I've come to is that there isn't a single bank I know where the chief operating officer is actually a qualified process engineer or a qualified engineer in anything. They've come from finance. They've come from running a line business like transaction banking. They've come from, you know, there's lots of people involved, so they must, as long as they're a good people leader, we'll put them into operations. So that we don't have trained professionals actually running operations within a banking context. Therefore, these questions just don't get asked. And what seems to me is that most industries, they have a function that dominates. And, you know, if you want to get to be CEO, you've got to have worked in that function. So, you know, if you want to be the CEO of BMW or VW, et cetera, you know, you have to have been an automotive engineer. You have to run engineering at some time. If you want to sort of be the CEO of Nike, you have to have worked in marketing and brand. If you want to sort of be the CEO of a bank, you have to have run relationship. And it's all about the relationship. You know, sort of ops is so far away from it. So what that means is that the quality of the operational decision-making, the quality of the tools and techniques and mechanics, they're not there. And every time I felt we've got close, because, you know, you need someone reporting directly to the CEO to sponsor this. Every time I felt we've got close, because I've always positioned myself as, I'm the technical person that can actually sort of make this happen for you. You just have to sponsor me and trust me to do it. And then, you know, two years in, the function's blown up. The chief operating officer disappears, goes to another job. Someone comes in who just doesn't believe it and throws everything out and wants to start again. And so, you know, my last 2 years at ANZ, we built what was called the world-class delivery model, which once again, it was just like business excellence. And we were starting that walk through the process maturity walk. And it was across the whole of the bank's operations. Mm-hmm. And we'd got sort of most teams up to level 2, 18 months in. And then the CEO had been off visiting ING and also Spotify and decided that we were going to do agile. And so everything else just stopped. And we suddenly became an agile bank. But no one had thought it through. So, you know, you're a heavily regulated business and suddenly all of our key decisions are on post-it notes sticking on a glass window. And then at the end of the week, the cleaners took them all off and threw them in the bin. You know, this is our regulatory documentation that just disappeared. And, you know, people weren't thinking that the decisions you make, if you want to have a green thumbs up or a blue thumbs up or a new emoticon, you can make that decision in 2 weeks and implement it if you've got the right sort of data infrastructure. Mm-hmm. You just can't do that in banking. And so, I mean, this is a really long-winded answer, Bernard, because I don't really have a good answer for you in terms of the type of models that I would have put in place. Say I've tried multiple variants, multiple, you know, I've had at least three goes and still haven't been able to make it work. And it's nearly always been the politics which has sort of undermined it. The teams, people love it. They're desperate to, you know, the operators, they're just desperate for knowledge, desperate to want to do things better. But the tech guys get all the money and the senior execs don't understand it. So they'll just sort of, you know, they'll just plow on.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions or are we all done, Adriano?
I don't see any other question in the chat. So I think we are done.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Selman. We still got attendees, or are they sort of dialing now for another session?
We still have attendees, but I think they're here for the show. Probably they're waiting for us to
disappear.
To close the session.
Yeah, they are now.
In the beginning, I had in the very early beginning of your presentation, when you have shown this BPM life cycle, and you said that the life cycle cannot be applied as it is. I was thinking that this is the first step that you are detailing. Finally, because the first step, what is the name of the first step? Remind it me.
So identify processes, and then discover them.
Identifying and discovering processes requires understanding the enterprise.
Yep, That's right.
And everything that you are doing, finally, from my first impression, is to going in deep in this understanding the enterprise in order to be able to understand about the business processes.
That's correct. And that's very much dependent on the role you have. But if you go into a team where your primary responsibility is day-to-day running, you don't have the luxury or the time to do that. And that's all it is. It's still a critical step. And all of the steps in that life cycle are absolutely valid. It just wasn't the one that, you know, my logic before I started the job was I was going to do exactly that. I needed to understand even though I'd done a similar job before, I needed to understand the systems, the process, how it worked, which teams did which. I need to discover them. Then I'd go and do my analysis, find my opportunities for improvement, put my program together, how I was going to improve, implement it, and then make sure that the changes were going to be successful. I just didn't have that luxury. I was just being beaten up every single day. And so I was living off my own wits to an extent. And I had to put all my energy into that sort of monitor and control, because everything I was being evaluated on was, did we do what we said we were going to do today? You know, did we process all the payments? Did we breach any sort of controls? Did we have any issues with regulators? I didn't have time to step back from it and review it the way I look. Now, if I'd had the money, if I'd had a budget, I would have had people doing that in the background, just feeding me the information. But that was part of the challenge. Because I didn't have the money, I didn't have the skills and the resources to do it. It was relying on my native understanding of how a payments business works, plus just being able to almost like do that process discovery in real time by asking questions. So I guess I was doing it, but it wasn't a formal part of the cycle. And I think that's why I say, you know, if in my very first role in banking, in that head of operational support or the manufacturing role, that's exactly what I did. That is exactly. Now, what I didn't realize was how irritating I was being to the other line managers, because I was creating all this work for them when they were constantly dealing with the stresses of the day. And yeah, they could see the benefit of what I was asking them to do at a future point. But they might not be here. They might have been sacked by the time that future point arrives. And it was how to get that happy medium and happy balance with the skills and resources you have available. So, clearly as a presentation, it was deliberately contentious, because I think there is so much incremental value that can be created for runtime leaders, which will help the two halves work together much more synergistically and much more easily than what we had to do to try and make it work together. You know, I mean, I was learning as I was going, and I was very fortunate that the person running the change was so easy to work with and would pay for all the stuff I want. Because basically, he put the BPM lifecycle into play. I didn't. I told him what I wanted, but it was his team that executed it because he had the resources. I just had to make sure that every day we survived to live another day.
There are other constraints in the reality. But anyway, I liked at the end your double intertwined ellipses.
Thank you.
I found it a nice representation of this reality. Thank you very much for your presentation.
Okay, see you.
See you, bye-bye.
See you, Adriana. I'll
talk
to you tomorrow.
See you.
Take care.